Welcome into the Champion's Journey. I am Corey McCartney. In this episode, we put our focus squarely on the intersection of sports and technology and companies that are pushing the boundaries in so many areas. You'll hear from Dr. Tom House and Rocky Collis of Mustard, which is taking the work of Dr. House, the renowned performance coach, and pushing it to the masses through their app. Then PlaySide's Scott McMeekin stops by to discuss how their company uses AI technology and streaming to open up an entire new world of sports broadcasting. And FanFood's Carson Goodale discusses how his app is positioned to thrive as cashless and on-demand transactions become the norm at sports and entertainment venues. And then finally, Proteus's Sam Miller joins me to talk about how smart resistance training systems such as his is just the beginning of a company that looks to hit every facet of improving human health and performance. Without further ado, let's kick things off with the folks from Mustard. Welcome in Rocky Collis and Dr. Tom House, co-founders of Mustard, an app that brings world-class coaching to athletes of all ages. Rocky, Dr. House, thanks for the time.
My pleasure. Good to be
thanks
here.
Thanks for having us.
Mustard utilizes existing smartphone technology. It's based on the decades of teaching and data collection by Dr. House, who obviously a resume as a coach is unparalleled, along with the work of renowned mental performance coach Jason Goldsmith. What was the need that you two saw in the marketplace that sought to fill it with Mustard?
Rocky, you want to lead it off first?
Sure, happy to. Corey, in short, most kids end up quitting sports by the time they're about 13 or 14. And we think that's because they don't have access to reasonable coaching. Coaching gets expensive. And so at a certain age, kids are playing against competition that's better than them because the competition's gotten good coaching and a lot of kids have it. We saw an opportunity with Tom House, who we really think is the most successful personal athletic coach of all time, to take the scientific methods he uses with the best athletes in the world, the Drew Breeses and Tom Brady's and Cole Hamels of the world, and give them to every kid on earth directly through a smartphone. We think that it's something that we like to say is going to revolutionize the power of play. It's going to give a lot of kids the opportunity to play sports longer in life and get to realize all the great character development that comes from being a part of a team sport a little bit later in life. The technology that was at our disposal to start this was ripe, and so the timing has to be right on these things, and we're lucky for us that it was, and we were able to recruit a team to get it done.
Certainly, a lot of things in terms of individual coaching have been elevated by COVID-19. Dr. House, did you sort of pick up on that as you saw Mustard being this opportunity to take things to the masses?
Well, I'd like to say that I understood everything that was going on with the technology. I knew our research and all our data capture and our models were second to none, whether it was biomechanics, functional strength, nutrition and sleep for recovery, or mental emotional for performance under stress and anxiety. I knew all that was really solid stuff, but I didn't realize until I started palling around with Rocky that there were some really, really smart people out there. I call them propeller heads, but that could actually take what was in my head and what we have been doing over the last 35, 40 years and actually become a mentoring device, like taking me and putting me in front of a family that had a 12 and an 11-year-old, or in your case, a 14 and 11-year-old, and afford you the same exact information and instruction that our elite athletes were getting. And so palling around with Rocky has kind of been a dream come true for me, because I thought it was stopping with me. And now it looks like we're going to be able to actually help and influence, a whole bunch of kids worldwide.
There are a number of mechanical analysis companies that exist, but they typically rely on an additional device to make it happen. How does Mustard work in terms of evaluating an athlete and providing feedback?
Yeah, it's really simple, Corey. So basically, we take any normal video. You can take a video through our app, or you can upload a video that you've taken on your phone or really any camera device. And in about 30 seconds, you get a biomechanical report card on your mechanics. And you get recommendations from Tom House that are tailored specific for your inefficiencies. We're right now in beta just with a pitching product, but very soon we'll be in all the sports that Tom is famous for. So we'll work with hitters, both baseball and softball, eventually we'll work with quarterbacks, and we'll work with golfers and tennis players pretty soon too.
Dr. House, are there model mechanics that you use as a foundational piece for this? And if so, who is it that makes up that model?
The model actually came from our research. I have right now a little over 900 major league pitchers in the computer at 1,000 frames a second. And we have, from that data capture, derived 11 variables that, if you follow the process from the most important variable down right down to the least important variable, you get, like Rocky said, you get an evaluation and a report card. And with that evaluation and whatever issues you have, we also have deliverables or teaches. It's personally adaptive. It's age specific. Think of it this way. There's one set of rules, but there's 100 million applications. And that's what we're probably, there's a lot of technology out there that can measure. In today's world, I think baseball has come a long way with measurement, but very few people can quantify and come up with a deliverable or a teach to fix what they measure.
How does it adjust to age? I mean, certainly Dr. House, one of your most famous clients, Nolan Ryan, you know, you could say maybe perfect mechanics there, but how does it adjust for say a child who's you know, looking to increase his mechanics, but obviously isn't anywhere in the skill level of a player of that magnitude?
That's a great question, Corey. And Rocky, I'll start it off, and then if I miss something, you can fill in. There are windows of trainability, and they're age-specific. And in general terms, your first window is neurological, and that's for male or female athletes from 6-7 years old until 12, 13, or 14, depending how quickly the hormones show up. The second window of trainability is muscle or strength, and that usually goes from 13, 14 until 18 or 19. The third window is skill acquisition, and that's when nerves and muscles can talk to each other. That's when you work on skill, and that window is 19 or 20 years old until 32 or 33. And then the last window is skill retention. And that probably gets the most visibility of what I'm doing right now because of the Drew Brees and the Tom Brady and, you know, athletes that are playing into their 40s. That last window, skill retention, it winds down. You can't beat father time or mother time or whatever you want to call it. 45 is about it. But there's no reason you can't do at 45 what you did at 25, as long as you have the proper process and application. Did that cover it, Rocky? Did I hit them all?
Yeah, no, I think you did. So I'll just add on a little bit to talk about how it works in the application. It's a really important question, Corey. I always tell people, if you look at the athletes across multiple sports, you know, the rotational sports that we're in, baseball, football, golf, you look at the folks that have had, you know, Hall of Fame level success into their 40s, a shocking percentage of them have trained with Tom House. So there's really something there to learn from him, not just in terms of enhancing performance in the short term, but making sure it lasts. So that's something we've been really thoughtful about. How are we going to build that into the app and make sure that people are getting age-specific advice? In the short term, we're going to do something really simple, which is just ask people to input their ages. And then based on the age that they input, they will get different recommendations back from the app. So as Tom was describing, at certain ages, it's going to be more exercise-based. At certain bases, it's going to be more positional or mechanical fixes. And we'll learn kind of how users are engaging with the app while we're in this beta phase, and we'll continue to build those age-specific features out.
Now, certainly, we're talking a lot about mechanics, fine-tuning mechanics. Where does the development of cognitive, social, emotional skills come into play?
I'll start it off, and again, Rocky, you can back me up. Yeah. I think Yogi Berra said it best, that 90% of sports are 50% mental. And in today's world, most of the kids go home because of what's going on between their ears. They give up because they're not having fun. They have performance anxieties. It becomes an outcome-based evaluation where they have a lot of trouble dealing with failure. And we've got a guy, he's obvious, I wish he was with us right now on this Zoom call, but we're actually able to measure what's going on in the brain in real time and find out how engaged a young man, you know, boy or girl are involved in their preparation or competition. It, you can actually, it looks like a sweatband, put it on, you can wear it underneath your hat, and it'll actually give real data on what's going on inside your brain, why the child is working or playing. So it's for the first time in the history of, we're able to quantify in real time, in practice and in competition, what these young people are going through mentally.
Yeah, so Tom House typically doesn't need any backup, but I'll try to just add on a little bit there. Jason Goldsmith, to me, is like the Tom House of mental performance training. So there's a lot of parallels in the way they work, and that's why they work so well together. So you think about Tom's career. For 45 years, he's been doing this intense scientific research about the way the body moves best for a particular sport. And not just the research, he then takes that research and figures out, as he said, what are the teachables to help people get their data to improve. So it's not just a matter of showing somebody there's this deficiency in the data, go ahead and correct it. It's a matter of experimenting with different teachables and figuring out, when you say something to somebody, how do they react? And what do they do with their body then to improve the data? So Tom has done the research and then figured out the teachables. And what's unique about Jason, as Tom was describing, Jason has this incredible piece of technology that he's worked with for many years now called the Focus Band. It's an EEG reader that measures athletes' brain frequencies. To my knowledge, it's the only EEG reader on the market that you can wear while you move around. So most EEG readers, you have to sit perfectly still. They're for meditating, or doctors use them in a doctor's office. Focus Band, we have sewn into some of our athletes' hats or helmets. Some of the Hall of Fame people that Tom and Jason work with that you would have heard of are using this on a day-to-day basis. Now, what that means is that Jason's done research just like Tom has. So for many years, Jason's been working with these top athletes. Primarily, he works with golfers. He tests out different protocols, different pre-shot routines, and he's able to actually, in real time, understand whether those protocols and routines help the athlete more consistently get into the flow state or the zone, or whether brain frequencies are jumping because of something Jason's saying, you know, or somebody's annoyed with his voice or whatever it may be. So Jason has these protocols that are scientifically proven, just like Tom does, and he's got these teachables that are scientifically proven. So for us, we have the opportunity first in the near term to democratize those protocols. So through the app, there's going to be a lot of mental performance training content from Jason and from Tom and from a bunch of our athletes and advisors. And it's not going to just be somebody's idea about what's good mental performance training content, but it's going to be these proven concepts that have been studied using Focus Band. And then eventually Focus Band is part of our company too. So we will be finding kind of more accessible ways to sell that product so that more people can experience the power of it. But really, you know, it's these protocols that have been scientifically proven that we're anxious to get out into the world and let kids benefit from them.
Couple bigger picture questions. I mean, certainly a lot of coaching situations that this applies to, but do you see this application where it can be utilized for scouting college recruiters? I mean, is that kind of a vision for it as well?
Go ahead, Rocky, because you've actually had hands-on in the last 3 or 4 months with exactly that. So
Yeah, no, I'm happy to answer that. Thanks. The answer is yes. There's lots of applications for that. We have lots of interest from Major League Baseball teams. As I tell everybody, including the teams that we're talking to, the mission and soul of the company is really to help young athletes and kids as much as we can. And so everything we're doing is with that mission and soul in mind and figuring out how we can do that better. Now for us to partner with, a couple major league teams, maybe one or two, is probably a good thing for the learnings that we'll get from that team in terms of, the things that we're capturing, the data we're capturing, the teachables that are being given to kids, and of course, in terms of a marketing partnership. So we'll do that. The scouting uses of our technology are, in fact, probably game-changing. It's just not the core of what we're interested in doing as a company, but we will allow it to be used some. The reason our technology is so important for scouting is because, unlike, I think, anything else I'm aware of out there, we can capture 3D biomechanical data from basically any camera angle. So a scout in the stands can take a video with the phone and get a 3D biomechanical report on a pitcher, for example. They don't have to set up a tripod and be at a very specific angle. So clearly there's a lot of interest in that from a scouting standpoint. For us, you know, I think the more interesting scouting thing is really long-term. It's not something to be done in the next couple of years. But after we've been around for a while, you'll be able to look at somebody's biomechanical journey throughout their young life. We think that that's going to provide a lot more important insights into their projectability than the information that teams have now. So to be able to track how somebody moved when they were 13, 14, 15, all the way through 18, understand the differences, understand what they're maybe a little bit about their work ethic, we think that's going to end up speaking a lot more to projectability. So eventually there are some scouting, you know, kind of data licensing uses for us. In the short term, it's more about just using the technology while people are in the stands.
You guys have both mentioned, obviously in beta for baseball right now, plans to expand. I mean, you have the backing of the likes of Nolan Ryan, Drew Brees, Mia Hamm in advisory role. Clearly individuals who understand what it takes to reach the heights of their sport. I mean, and I think speaks to how meaningful this can be for in impacting future generations well beyond baseball.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And Corey, you know, before we started this interview, we talked about your boys, and there's point in time capacity and projectable capacity. So what we're able to do with this app is we could film your kids doing something in the backyard, and depending on what they filled out on their personal history, we could actually tell you their legs are contributing X to velocity, their torso is contributing X to velocity, their arms, put them all together. And if they've grown 3 inches and gained 15 pounds, that is a different model than if they haven't grown or gained any weight. In other words, we can identify point in time capacity and projected capacity, biological age and chronological age, from, like I said, first window at 7, 8 years old, all the way up to a 42 or 44 year old. So it does have application in the elite sports environment. It shortens trails for scouts, and it gives them a template that they can compare with their own data. We compliment everybody. We don't confront, we don't say that you're wrong and we're right, but I think we have the best complementary data that exists in sports today.
You have to ask about the name. I mean, certainly you think about put some mustard on it. Who came up with the name, and is that where it derived from?
Okay, Rocky, this is yours, because I sat for 7 hours one day and just watched the process. Yeah. And it ended up being just fine, but it was crazy. Go ahead, Rob.
Yeah, no, we went through a long naming process where we actually talked to a lot of youth athletes in the sports that we'll be in initially and tried to figure out what would resonate with them. It was really important to us that that we built a brand that is fun, right? I mean, part of the point of this, when we talk about the power of play, it's supposed to be play. And so we don't want our company to feel like a place people are coming to work. It's a place people are coming to improve at the thing that they play. And so mustard, yes, put some extra mustard on it, cut the mustard. Those were phrases that we heard from kids. And it kind of surprised us, but the fact that kids kind of knew those phrases made us start really thinking seriously about the name Mustard. And then it's just, it kind of checked all the boxes for us, right? Like, it's playful, it's accessible. You think about a hot dog at the ballpark, you know, the fact that it's a condiment rather than something super fancy sounding. So as we just played around with a bunch of names, it was the one that everybody fell for. I won't tell you the specific stories for the interview, but we had a couple other names that we ran across people in different cultures and different countries around the world, and they ended up being like meeting like these obscene things in other languages that we never would have thought of. So a couple names got scratched off because of that, but mustard rose to the top, let's say.
Well, I think we can all agree putting ketchup on a hot dog is blasphemy. So at least you guys went in the proper direction there. Want to shift directions in your own past of this endeavor, Dr. Hausnick. Every sports fan is familiar with you, even if they don't realize it. Obviously, is the pitcher who was in the bullpen catching Hank Aaron's historic 715th home run during your 8-year MLB career. You've been go on to coach the likes of Randy Johnson, Nolan Ryan, Brady Brees, Tim Tebow. been called the father of modern pitching mechanics. What is coaching and the development of players meant to you, and how has that experience helped shape a desire to take elite coaching and offer it to the masses?
Corey, I got really lucky. I hit the crease between old school and new school, where it was what you thought your eyes were telling you versus what technology could actually tell you. And I'd like to say it was well thought out and well planned out. It just kind of happened organically. So when I got involved with motion analysis in the late 80s, we actually captured data for a couple of years. I didn't even know what I was looking at. But eventually one day it started to permeate the concrete I call my brain, and we started seeing things that were really going on with movement. And it started off with baseball, but went to, like Rocky said, all rotational sports. And when we finally started being able to quantify real movements and then identify when a movement was improper, what the injury or the lack of performance that came with that inefficiency, then it got really smart. And then we figured out with movement, you have to have the functional strength to support that movement. You know, how many pitches is too many? How many is not enough? What you can accelerate or decelerate? And again, it sounds now like it was very well thought out. It was just luck of the draw and figuring out what did or didn't work. And pretty soon we had a movement model and a physical preparation model that matched up pretty solid. Then we realized that you have to recover from workloads and strength building, and if you're in a deficit, et cetera, et cetera. So recovery with nutrition and sleep, that added in, and then luck of the draw, the mental emotional stuff. My PhD is actually in performance psychology, so I always knew that what was going on between someone's ears was huge in the long haul, whether it was a little leaguer or a major leaguer. And then here comes Jason with the ability to measure it. So that's how it all fit together. And I think we're just scratching the surface. I think sports have come a long way, and there's some great research out there and some really smart people. But we've kind of jump-started. I think we're 4 or 5 years ahead of everybody with actually being able to put something in your hands or an athlete's hands that will actually help them.
Rocky, you were a pitcher in the Mariners system. Your brother Luke, a two-time Arena Bowl champ, was one of Dr. House's students. How did that relationship lead to this partnership and trying to help Dr. House's teachings, reach an entire new audience?
Yeah, well, first of all, I'm impressed to find anything about my baseball career. You had to do deep research. So
you were a 28th round pick, if I do believe.
That's right. Yeah, you really did research. I appreciate that. Yeah, for me, first of all, despite the fact that obviously my baseball career didn't go where I dreamt it would, I always knew how much value I was getting out of sports. So this was always, even when I was playing, I was working in after school centers in the off season, trying to help kids get more access to sports. This was always kind of, if I'm going to make a difference in the world, this was something I was passionate about, trying to figure out how we could get more kids to have access to the opportunities that I had. After I was done playing, after I got released and played independent ball a little bit, went to law school, got to work at some great law firms. And again, I noticed even in interviews for these law firms that, you know, all they wanted to talk about was my baseball career. And so I knew kind of how lucky I was to have had that and how meaningful it was to my life. I met Tom because my brother, as you mentioned, was a quarterback. He's training with Tom. And I used to, on my commute to my law office in LA, I would stop by and listen to Tom's Chalk Talks in the morning. I just felt like, first of all, they were so cool, right? There's all these Hall of Fame athletes there sitting around listening to Tom talk about mental approach to sports. But I also felt like they helped me kind of get focused and get in the zone for the day. So that's how I got to know Tom, was through my brother that way. Years later, I got much more into entrepreneurial work and became, you know, passionate about helping startup companies. And my brother suggested I talk to Tom and Jason that they had this idea for a startup company that might, you know, we might be able to find a way to work together. So that's how it all came together. And so for me, it's definitely a combination of lifelong passions that I'm super lucky to get to work on. To get to work on it with Tom House is just ridiculous for me. You can see behind me, I've got my Nolan Ryan Pitcher's Bible there, which is literally my copy from when I was a kid. It's a book that I literally, in large part, learned how to pitch from when I was young, and I've kept it all these years. And so now to actually work with Tom House for me is an unbelievable thrill. And I'm excited that we can take what's in his brain and get it out into the world in a way that's going to be personally adaptive for people. I think that's going to make a big difference.
Well, teachings that were once reserved for elite athletes only now have a new avenue. To request early access to beta testing, go to teammstrd.com. Give them a follow on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook, also at teammstrd. Rocky, Dr. House, thank you so much for the time.
Corey, thanks for your time also.
Thank you, Corey.
Now here's my conversation with PlaySight, Scott McMeekin. I am now joined by Scott McMeekin, PlaySight VP of Sales for North America. Scott, good to see you.
Great to see you, Corey.
Now, PlaySight brings smart sports AI video technology to any level and every sport via desktop and mobile. It's obviously something that's an integral part of business at Lake Point Sports. But Scott, give me that elevator pitch on how PlaySight's changing the game.
Yeah, I tell you what, we're all about connecting sports to the in rinks, fields, courts, to the internet. And you know, as you know, once they're connected, fans, parents, coaches, recruiters can all access the content. And Lake Point's, you know, certainly at the forefront of that, driving content with Lake Point Live.
Now, PlaySight affords users the ability to live stream in real time with multiple angles, cut their own highlights. Basically, as you mentioned, connecting the likes of athletes, family members, scouts, recruiters. I know the company has a global footprint. It's kind of a fun exercise to go to the global smart court locator map on PlaySight.com and see how far reaching it is. How long has it taken PlaySight to get that level of reach in the market?
Yeah, I tell you, since 2013, they've been adding smart courts throughout really the world. And it's to a point now where you can take a tennis racket and fly to a city and look up, you know, where's that smart court in your area. Pretty fun exercise. So they've been going at it, and certainly in the recent years, adding places like Lake Point and IMG and working with about half the NBA now, which you can't get on those courts, unfortunately. It's really exploded to where, you know, most cities in North America have, you know, some basketball, some tennis, and then more recently, quite a bit of baseball and hockey, where you can connect. And as an athlete, you can go on court and see yourself on video. And, you know, in my case, realize how slow you are, how maybe old you are. But in the case of a lot of people at Lake Point, really see what you're doing well and maybe see some things that you might work on.
Headquartered in Israel, when did that move come, as far as you were aware of, to get a inroad into the United States?
You know, so I've been with the company a little over 3 years now, and I know they were at it for a couple years before I joined. So my guess is they've been in the U.S. Going on about 5 years. And we really made our start in tennis, and are at some pretty incredible, you know, country clubs and racket clubs. And then facilities like the USTA down in Orlando. And then got into basketball probably about that 4 or 5 year mark as well. Did quite a bit of work with the NBA level that I mentioned. And then also at the D1 college level, certainly in tennis and then in basketball. And then in the last handful of years, baseball. Certainly starting with Lake Point as a showcase. We work with places like USA Baseball and St. Louis Cardinals. And we've got kind of a unique approach to it that is nice from a sales perspective, where you get to start with the pro level teams, get that validation, and then you're able to bring those into facilities and colleges and high schools and you know, really youth. So there's nothing like better than, you know, hopping on a field like you have at Lake Point, where you got 7 cameras on a field. I think it's even more than our MLB teams tend to have. So.
In terms of your involvement with PlaySight, when was that moment that you felt that things were really clicking, or that you guys had got to the point where it's like, okay, this thing's about to really take off?
You know, it really started when I joined, and not so much for me, but that's when I really felt, you know, the company was expanding into different sports, the trajectory and the brands that we were having an opportunity to work with. And then personally, you know, even coming up to Lake Point and getting on the field with Mark and cutting some highlights and, you know, showing, you know, having fun with it. And that's when it really kind of came home that, hey, this is a real chance to impact, you know, some athletes and, you know, probably jump into a question coming up, but it's been interesting with COVID. You know, it has really helped these kids get looked that they might not have gotten before. And I think it's also helped a lot of these college recruiters, and in MLB for that matter, that can't travel, still get to see the content that you put out, you know, just incredibly every day.
At its baseline, let's talk about how PlaySite works. I mean, at Lake Point, you had mentioned there's cameras throughout the Champion Center. Each field at the Baseball Village has users be able to watch from, you know, multiple angles. There's live games. There's on-demand games. You can watch on web. You can watch on mobile. And obviously, there's the smart court technology itself. So how does this happen without the traditional broadcast for a user to get that experience via PlaySite?
Yeah, so, you know, there is a basketball perspective, there is a camera that actually tracks the action. And so the players and the play is going up and down the court of the ice, and it's following the movement. It's uncontrolled. It's an unmanned camera that's up in the ceiling. And then more recently, you've seen this in baseball at Lake Point. We're actually live streaming from multiple angles. So a typical MLB production, you can see a center field view, and then you can see a high home view. We now have the ability to live stream those angles and let the user pick which angle they want. I had another customer recently, they're live streaming high home, but it's a right-handed pitcher. They're also live streaming the third base because they want that scout to be able to see, you know, from the open side. And so that's been a real trend where the consumer is able to control which angles they want to see. And, you know, with the, you know, up to however many events that are done every year, I think it's incredible. It's every weekend up at Lake Point, the hundreds of games. It's something that you can scale. And so the ability to record, not have the production cost that you would have with the typical production company. It allows you to do games. It also allows you to record practices. So what happens a lot in producing these events, it's so costly that you can't actually turn the camera on for practice. And so the unmanned is really a way to scale that. And that's where I think, you know, the future is going. We have had some experiences as well where we do bring in a production company. You know, in the case, you know, we brought in a production company, or Lake Point brought in a production company for the recent area code games. And they were able to not only set up their own cameras, their own commercials, but also tap into some existing cameras. And so you have almost a semi-automatic production at that point.
You kind of mentioned this a little bit, obviously, you know, COVID-19 and kind of steps that have been made have allowed you guys to kind of expand the applications for PlaySite. But you think about family members watching from afar, colleges checking in on a player, scouts. One interesting area, I think, is in player development. How have you witnessed teams and organizations be able to utilize PlaySite to help make their athletes better?
Yeah, it's certainly from a pro level perspective, whether it's the, you know, the Cardinals we work with, or the Atlanta Hawks here locally, they're buying the technology for player development primarily. You know, they have live streaming figured out. So certainly the majority of our pro-level customers are using it for player development. I'm seeing quite a bit, you know, from a recruiter perspective, where high schools are taking the content and using the multiple angles to, one, improve their athletes, but also use it to show it off to potential colleges. The ability to slow it down, you know, I got on a tennis court myself, and one, I looked pretty bad, but two, I could realize really quickly what I was doing wrong and try it again. And so, you know, instant replay, we see it largely in live sports, but I think instant replay is really helpful as well from player development. So if I, you know, make a pitch or make a swing, the ability to go over to a tablet right away and back up 10 seconds, back up 1 minute, watch what I just did, and then do it again is really valuable. You know, on the side, I'm a USA hockey coach, and it doesn't matter how many times I tell, you know, a player where they should be, you know, it never completely sinks in until they see video sometimes. And then they really quickly, oh, I see what you mean. You know, I need to be here and not here. So, you know, video from a real-time feedback I think it's a really powerful tool, you know, more so than, you know, kind of the traditional ways that we've always done it with dry erase boards and all kinds of gimmicks.
Certainly, we're talking about the intersection of technology and sports, and in that, you know, understanding of technology is a big part of this. But obviously, if you're going to work in sports and have that understanding of what matters to athletes and coaches, it helps to have a passion for sports yourself. So, Scott, where did that passion for sports come from for you?
Yeah, I grew up like maybe a lot of people playing different sports. Grew up watching sports. You know, I played baseball, played certainly tackle football and hockey, et cetera. And then got into coaching, and it was more as my kids got older, I would, you know, coach the team that they were on. You know, there's something about a team, and there's something about the dynamics of a team, and, you know, maybe not having the best team, but if you came together as a team and you played as a team, you could beat a lot of other teams that maybe had were better in a lot of ways, and more skilled, but maybe didn't play as a team. And I always enjoyed sort of the underdog story. And I've had, you know, different experiences, you know, throughout the years that many other people have, whether rooting for one of those teams or being a part of one of those teams. You know, I think the other thing is, and this is what I love about what we do, you know, athletes and connecting to athletes and then coaches, you know, you run into a few crazy ones every once in a while, but generally they're really good people that you know, want the best for the game, want the best for their athletes. And so I just love talking to coaches. I love learning from coaches, and they're always looking for that edge to get better and to improve their team. And it's something that it's fun. You do have to walk onto a basketball court and sort of know that lingo and know that language. And then the next day, you know, go to a baseball diamond and know that lingo. And, you know, the next day put on some skates. So it does make it kind of fun.
How did that all help just shape your approach to business, whether it's, you know, working with a team, you know, an actual team, or working with a team within PlaySight?
Yeah, you know, it's sports keep score. There's runs and there's a scoreboard. You know, and in the world of sales, there's a scoreboard. It's very specific. Did you hit your number or not? So, you know, from a just keeping score and where do you really stand, that was something that, you know, assuming you're ahead of your number, I always was able to relate to it as winning. It's also competitive. You know, there's you can get the juices going on a sales call. In a lot of ways, similar to a game. You've got your preparation for the event. You've got the actual event. You have the follow-up. You have the second game sometimes. And so there's a lot of similarities. You know, there's been a lot of books and certainly movies, you know, whether it's Moneyball or, you know, in any of the other ones we could quote all day long, the connection between sales and sports. But it's, you know, PlaySight and certainly Lake Point have been just a lot of fun to be a part of. And, you know, sometimes I come home and I can't tell my wife, you know, what I did that day because I was hanging out on the baseball field. And it doesn't sound like work to some people. We were working really hard, but we were on a baseball field. So it's you get to see a lot of things.
Well, you can find out more about PlaySight at PlaySight.com or follow them across social media at PlaySight. Scott, thank you so much for the time.
Appreciate it, Corey. Take care.
Now let's hear from Fan Foods, Carson Goodale. Welcome in, Carson Goodale, co-founder and CEO for Fan Food, the online and mobile ordering platform. Carson, thanks for the time.
Yeah, thanks for joining. Happy Friday.
Absolutely. You too. Now, Carson, Fan Food started with the mission of transforming stadium concessions through on-demand cashless ordering, straight-to-seat delivery. How has your company's world changed this year, and what, you know, really was a nice to have feature for properties has turned into a necessity going forward and has applications that go well beyond sports and entertainment?
Yeah. So I think when COVID started back in March, kind of like at the end of quarter one, part of our strategy to adapt was, you know, recognizing that, you know, events and stuff were going to be canceled and suspended. You know, that's our main market. So what are we going to do? And we prioritize kind of our efforts to focus on opportunities where we could continue to cash flow the business because, you know, you know, we have a lot of a big team, and where can we also deliver the biggest impact? And, you know, we went into some new spaces like drive-in movies. In 1950, there were over 5,000 movie theaters across America, right? Today, there's only a few hundred. But, you know, when COVID hit, our solution was a perfect contactless ordering, order from your car, get concessions delivered. You know, you can pick them up in advance. And so we did really well in that space and continue to do so today. So that's pretty cool. Some other venues and stuff that we've gone into with our technology include malls, hotels, just kind of anywhere, beachside. So one of our sales reps signed a hotel, and the really interesting use cases: beachside service, poolside service, anywhere that you can, any kind of event, whether that's athletic events or recreational activities, leisure, anything where, you know, we can help support a contactless social distance environment with our, you know, cashless technology is where we're excited to be, right? I mean, that's where we feel like the future is. You know, we started this business 6 years ago with the idea that, you know, fans don't like to wait, you know, in long lines. So how do we make that ordering process as frictionless as possible? How do we make the technology as easy to use, knowing that, you know, a booster club parent behind a concession stand, you know, versus all the way up to food service, right? So I think if anything, what COVID has done is just kind of reaffirmed the why we do what we do kind of thing. Another one of our concepts that we spun up during this time too was a concept called buildingeats.com. So you think the common theme are these venues, right? These venue types, you know, we have stadiums, arenas. Okay. So this one's a building. And so residents can order from their building, local food trucks and restaurants, and it's a pre-delivery service. But the benefit really to the restaurants is it's commission free. So it aims to really create a real impact, because when you have residents ordering from your buildings, the goal for us is, you know, how can we consistently get, you know, 50, 100 orders at a time? And with those average, and then from a marketing perspective, we really work on how do we optimize that menu? And we have a lot of data to help them, you know, kind of, you know, drive those AOVs higher. So, you know, the restaurant person that's delivering those bulk orders, you know, it's worth their while. So, yeah, a lot of different crazy stuff going on during COVID, but staying busy.
And certainly you guys had a leg up in trying to pivot. I mean, you had, you know, properties, 300 North American properties. I mean, it was probably a lot easier for you guys to pivot knowing that you had a proven system as opposed to somebody who saw an opportunity and decided to capitalize on it.
Yeah, definitely. We had closed our first institutional round of capital back in quarter one of 2019. And one of the priorities was, how do we take this, the platform that we have, not scalable, and how do we make it scalable? And so, you know, a big part of that investment was creating the you know, technology and the infrastructure to support those kinds of properties.
The obvious is we really don't know when we're going to return to the level of sports and event attendance that we used to see. I don't know if you saw this week, but Dodgers co-owner Todd Boehly said at the Milken Institute of Global Conference, he doesn't expect baseball in particular to return to the normal fan experience until 2022. And we could have the smaller cap crowds like we've had, you know, the NLCS and World Series. Whether he's right or not, I mean, you have to feel that the fans have been conditioned over this time period to embrace this ordering system. And that really puts you guys in a unique position.
Yeah. You know, I think for some of the venues that have, chosen to stay active during this time that use our platform, we have seen massive spikes in the, you know, utilization rates that we've never seen pre-COVID, which is beneficial. Yeah. But I do agree with some of that. But I would envision, you know, within kind of like the first 6 months of events really opening back up, kind of this spike, everyone's going to have, like, you know, want to rush back into the events and probably start to kind of see this dip. But yeah, you're exactly right. We have conditioned people to, you know, take in sports and everything at home and, you know, from their seats. And, but I think that you know, some of the surveys that we sent out, we found that there's a percentage of fans that actually are, you know, will likely go to more events because of COVID, because of what this has actually caused, you know, people staying cooped up and everything. So the likelihood of them going back and continuing to go back, there's some that actually say that, you know, the attendance rates will actually be higher. So it's kind of interesting.
Huh. So when you think about when things do ramp up, I'm imagining, you know, the likes of maybe some existing companies, Grubhub, Uber Eats, even proprietary into maybe MLB, NFL, other leagues, you're probably going to see more competitors. So as you guys continue to have your foothold, what's going to continue to set FanFood apart?
Well, first of all, the customers that we serve, when we went into the market, back in 2014, 2015, when I started the company, when we went into high schools and youth sports complex and minor league teams. And we, you know, at first, when we built the FanFood app, we took those into those markets because those types of accounts didn't have the budgets to justify white labeled apps. That was common in the professional sports and D1, but everyone has their own kind of white labeled, you know, solution. And so how do we continue to provide that great customer experience? It's, you know, we're kind of at a point now, some of the technologies and features and functionality that we're rolling out solve the unique kind of pain points that, you know, of our primary customer. And I think that's like really important. And we prioritize their needs, from a, you know, product roadmap perspective. And I think that's really important, how we stay ahead, continue to provide the best in class kind of software, you know, service to the customers that we serve. That's a really important piece. There are some things that we're working on, with some pro teams right now, some solutions we had built out, part of our in-venue kind of delivery application. We're expanding some of that, really running with that, introducing new features and functionalities that haven't, you know, existed in the marketplace yet, which I'm super excited about. And then with our platform, we start to think about, you know, we started with FanFood pre-COVID, right? That's the name. We built a brand around that. But I think what COVID has done is, you know, really shine light and the technology and what we have. And today we serve more than just fans and food on our platform. There are some of our accounts that are using it to try to kind of own the entire digital journey. They're selling merchandise. They're selling tickets. Our categories are customizable. And so your pre-order stores are tickets right before you get in. And we have the whole kind of thing. And then if you start to think about from a data perspective, once you start to control all of that data and everyone's using that, you know, as the primary means of placing purchases inside of an event, what are some of the implications longer term from a data perspective? And what kind of value can you create for the properties and for the teams that you're serving? And I think that's something that becomes really, really competitive and interesting.
That is king, right? Everybody tells us that. I want you to kind of go back to the beginning here. And I mean, it almost has to feel kind of quaint to think about not wanting to stand in line at a game or an event now to what you guys are currently doing. But at what point in the FanFood process did you kind of feel like this thing and this idea you had gone from a vision to a breakthrough?
There isn't, I'll be honest, there's not a point where you're like, this is going to be huge. You know, it's more of like, it's an evolution and it's a constant, like, you know, there's always a new problem around the corner. There's always something that's going along. Like, there's challenges and so many roadblocks that you come into over and over and over again. And I'll be the first to say, like, we're not, you know, I don't even consider FanFood where we're at today, like a breakthrough. So, you know, so to speak, I still feel like there's things that we have to do as a business to kind of get to where we want to go and do it in a sustainable way. Right. And I think that's really important. And so, you know, definitely still have a lot to go, but it's an evolution. It's a marathon, not a sprint. That's for sure.
Having that connection to sports and working in sports is obviously key, but you interestingly bring that military background. How beneficial did you find that discipline in the nascent stages of a startup, but then the persistency of trying to build it on a daily basis?
I doubled down on those leadership skills that I learned in the military, because I think there's a lot of times where, you know, it's your baby, right? And you're attached to it. But there's also a lot of times where like, hey, I'm not the subject matter expert when it comes to technology or product or there. And so it's a really interesting kind of balance to recognize that early on and say like, how can we, you know, get the right people to fill the right seats that are, you know, can, you know, similar, can work well together, the culture that we want to fit. And, you know, I think all of those things are, super, super important, right? Super, super important to do. So
tell me where you see FanFood when we're finally packing stadiums and venues again, and how much stronger is the company because of the way you guys were able to pivot during COVID?
I think, 10 times stronger, 100 times, the stronger the, you know, what I think pre-COVID, what we saw was, you know, it was common to see like 1-3% of people in attendance, like using our technology to play. So I think that was kind of like the industry standard. And now we're seeing 10% all the way up to 100% of people. And so I think some of those kind of data points, you know, my investors might have said that those were a pipe dream, you know, a year ago, and now those are the reality. And I think, you know, it's going to just introduce new problems and new things to solve for. And how do we, you know, and it's just, yeah, they're all exciting things. But I think it's going to be really, really great for the industry, right? Because we've been talking about, you know, concessions haven't changed. The process hasn't changed in a hundred, you know, hundreds of years since the beginning of sports. And the biggest pain point as a fan has been waiting 20 minutes in line and in that crowded, congested concourse that no one likes to wait in and would rather wait in their seats with their friends. And that's why they spent all the money to be there in the first place. And they want to get that memorable experience. And we built our business around. So it's kind of, refreshing in a weird kind of way with COVID, right? It's that the technology that COVID has caused a massive evolution in technology, and it's something that I see the sports industry adopting, you know, really well, really well, and it's really cool to see. Really cool to see that kind of adoption from the tech, you know, in the sports space adopting it. And and we're really fortunate to be able to continue to do what we do and would love to do.
Well, for more on FanFood, go to fanfoodapp.com or follow them on Twitter at FanFood On Demand or on Facebook and Instagram at FanFood App. Carson, thank you so much for the time.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me, Corey.
Now, here's Proteus's Sam Miller. I'm pleased to welcome in Sam Miller, CEO of Proteus. Sam, appreciate you carving out some time.
Happy to be here, Corey. Thanks so much.
Absolutely. Now, as we look at this intersection of sports and technology, there are few companies that meet that head on more than Proteus, just revolutionized resistance training. There's so much of a focus in recent years with technology finding its way into everything in training. I mean, there's exercise bikes, rowers, et cetera. But what, in your estimation, had been missing from elite training and recovery equipment, and how has Proteus helped to fill that market void?
Sure. I mean, I think you're seeing it in this connected devices space that's been exploding in the last couple of years. A lot of the concentration of that has been for at-home products. And now there, at the same time, there's been incredible advancements with new sports tech in the kind of elite sports training realm. But there's a huge gap between those two spaces. And to me, everyone's kind of putting a sensor on an old piece of equipment. And no one's really looking at the equipment and trying to develop a new, better, more efficient, hardware tool or equipment for training. And that's where we started. What we're doing, we like to think of it as really a reinvention of strength training and recovery. And what this new type of equipment allows you to do is to measure human performance in a new way, which is strength in three dimensions for the first time ever.
Proteus's ability to measure, track, and assess an athlete, provide feedback, and tailor workouts has so many far-reaching applications, strength training and rehab. I watched a video with former MLB pitcher Chris Capuano. He lauds the machine's ability to be so fluid. How is Proteus able to take a user's movement patterns and turn it into something that's so very unique and personalized?
Sure. I mean, I think the beauty of the system is that it doesn't force users to move a certain way. So all of the kind of improvements of, you know, as it relates to, you know, movement patterns and optimized movement patterns, it really comes from the user themselves, right? By organically and naturally being able to, you know, feel the resistance, feel the movement pattern, produce force from the ground up. And that then translates to these kind of rapid improvements across the board. On the measurement side, I mean, because our patented resistance is truly multiplanar, which is the first time ever that capability's ever existed, it allows us to measure in three dimensions. So we have invested a lot of time and energy in our software products to allow you to visualize what power production, for example, looks like in three-dimensional space.
Let's talk about the inner workings a little bit. Electromagnetic brakes to produce resistance, the ability to replicate 25 machines in one, a full range of attachments. Those of us, you know, I'm someone who's been a personal trainer for a long time, you know, heavily involved in fitness for decades, that they love that, you know, concept of free weights and array of machines. But especially when it comes to elite athletes, there's an efficiency in the work of training and rehabbing. Is that really part of the effectiveness in your eyes, is to take these elite athletes and give them something they can be very efficient with?
Absolutely. I mean, efficiency is one of our main selling points. I will say, though, the technology that we've developed, it's a totally new modality for resistance training. And we're introducing it to the market with some really exciting success, but it's not positioned as a total replacement, right? So we're not saying, hey, stop everything that you've been doing for decades and use Proteus. We're saying use Proteus to accelerate what you're already doing. And you can do that through a couple different ways. So there's efficiency that comes through a couple different avenues. One is through the actual results that you're that you get physically. We've proven clinically through the Hospital for Special Surgery, the number one orthopedic hospital in the United States, that Proteus produces up to 95% greater peak muscle activation and muscle activation duration compared to free weights and a cable machine. So there's this neuromuscular stimulation component to this that is tied directly to motor learning, coordination, proprioception, balance, and efficient movement. That's really, really powerful. And then separately, of course, the fact that resistance is in all planes and directions means you can actually do two exercises in the time of one. So from a testing perspective, it's insanely efficient, which allows, you know, one of our products is a strength and power report, which is a full body analysis or breakdown of where your power is coming from. And a user will go through 17 exercises in under 4.5 minutes.
Wow. How has COVID-19 changed the appetite for technology-driven training and what you've experienced? I mean, is it there an even greater importance when you consider the automated workouts that are a part of your system?
Without question. I mean, for us, we've seen really a net positive impact on not just our business, but interest in the technology. And I think it's because of a couple different reasons. One of them, I think the most obvious to us anyways, is as athletes are kind of becoming, you know, there are greater barriers for athletes to complete their training. And some of them that are forced to do some of that at home, you know, power is one of the first things that you lose in detraining. And you know, you lose power before strength. And so what Proteus does, it allows you to actually monitor power and measure it in a completely new way in an insanely short period of time, but also train it in a really rapid fashion. So it's a phenomenal tool for maintaining and improving power output, which is essential when you have these kind of, you know, periods of time when you can't go to the gym. I think the second thing, though, is really from a business standpoint, we've seen that the sports performance gyms that we serve anyways have been doing quite well. I mean, there's obviously been struggles here, but it's a very different landscape than commercial big box fitness. And we think that's because athletes in particular, they really have greater needs and desires for hands-on, in-person, specialized and highly skilled instruction. And so our technology being a tool that empowers trainers to deliver a better quality of service has fit in really nicely there.
Well, it's called elite training for a reason, right? That's right. Proteus had a kiosk at Lake Point Sports Baseball Village this summer to provide athletes with an assessment to get full body strength and power reports, detect for imbalances, compare them to athletes at different elite levels. While you currently have machines in the hands of MLB, NHL, and Division I sports teams, is that, in your mind, Proteus's next wave of getting to that generation that's so already tied into to data and tech?
Absolutely, and we're already doing it. The pro institutions that we serve right now are a starting point for us. They have been phenomenal partners. We've been really lucky to have this incredible group of early adopter customers that are really invested in what we're doing. But our vision here is that this technology in its various forms is going to be ubiquitous in all locations where human health and performance is valued. And that goes way beyond sports. But we've expanded our footprint for our systems into markets that serve competitive athletes of all sport types and all age ranges with a lot of success. And as the software gets better, which it does rapidly and over time, some of these products are really focused on self-service capabilities. So you can actually walk up without any staff member present and actually receive in a matter of minutes, one of these strength and power reports, just as one example.
You kind of touched on it there a little bit, but certainly from a data collection standpoint, and as you guys, look to allow athletes to compare and stack themselves up against at different ages and different levels of athleticism. I mean, certainly having that expanded reach just certainly allows you guys to have a much broader software operation and probably offering in terms of allowing these guys to find out how they do stack up.
Absolutely. There's tremendous network effects here. The more data we capture, the more valuable the product is. And then that cycle continues. We've deliberately placed our systems or engaged with clients that allow us to access environments where we're actually able to build that data set more and more. It's growing rapidly with only, a couple dozen of our version one machines out there in the world. We are, our top performing sites are performing almost 700 monthly sessions on Proteus per site. They're getting incredibly high usage and we're capturing a ton of data. The entire purpose of it is, of course, the athlete owns the data. We just use that de-identified information so that we can provide more value on the software side.
Such an interesting journey for Proteus. I mean, your father's prototype built to help you during your own sports rehabbing as a child. What was it about that experience of trying to find a rehab solution and bridge the gap between rehab training and actually on the field movements that led you down this path?
Sure. Yeah. It's interesting story, but I had a long history of injuries starting in my knees when I was 9 years old. I spent years in between rehab and peak performance and back again. And I was just really, really frustrated with the lack of access to objective performance data, one, right? And inefficient fitness equipment and training tools that I viewed as they hadn't changed in decades. And so I envisioned a technology that was able to solve both of those problems. But in order to do so, you have to start with the hardware. We got to create a new and better tool that's really going to be focused on not isolating specific muscles and joints, but focused on rapidly strengthening, enhancing, restoring movement patterns.
How much of what we're seeing today with Proteus actually mirrors the prototype that your dad built?
Probably about 3-5%. The impetus or the genesis for Proteus in and of itself. I mean, it really came from was inspired by a lot of the work that my father was doing at MIT in the early 90s and then continued to be tinkering in the basement of my house growing up. So without question, a lot of the inspiration comes from the mechanical side of things, comes from his work, which was truly brilliant. What we've done today, though, is kind of stratospheres beyond you know, what he had envisioned and what he was working on, but it wouldn't have been possible without the work that he was doing. But we've got an incredible team that is kind of spread out across the country, but primarily located in the New York City area. And, you know, this team has just provided some unbelievable value that we think is, you know, tying into a revolutionary product that's going to transform, and is already starting to transform these spaces.
I know with the help of late NBA Commissioner David Stern, you were able to add fundraising for and help in research and development of version 2 of the system. Where does the company stand in terms of that work?
There's only so much I can share, but at this particular moment, but version 2 has all the same functionality as version 1. It's just really mass manufacturable, and is a lot more stable, durable, and commercially ready and available. We have some incredibly exciting development going on. We are probably about a couple of months away from being able to share what that actually looks like, and you know a little bit about the product and do a full announcement. But we are targeting for an early spring 2021 launch of that product.
Well, without giving anything else away, I mean, where do you see this going? Do you see this as something where it becomes as ubiquitous as people having it in their homes? Do you see it as something where, you know, schools all over the country are making this part of their, you know, their development of their own athletes? How far do you see this going?
Without question, this technology in its current and future forms, it will be ubiquitous. It will be in, as I said earlier, it will exist in all facility types where human health and performance is valued. That includes the home. It includes doctor's offices. It includes rehab facilities and medical institutions. And of course, it includes commercial fitness. So it's really all the above. Of course, the road to getting there does not mean pursuing all those markets at once. They behave very differently. There's very different dynamics, and there's different product needs. So we are heavily focused and invested right now in sports performance and sports medicine.
All right. Well, for more on Proteus, you can visit proteusmotion.com or follow them on Instagram and Twitter @ProteusMotion. Sam, thank you so much for the time.
Thank you, Corey. Appreciate it.